or socially. I think it's got gradually better over the 16 years since then, but we're still not a fair city in terms of the opportunities that our education system gives to young people. Obviously, we've got independent schools. I wouldn't abolish them. I think parents have the right to make that choice for their child if they wish to. But we still have an economic divide in between different parts of the city. And we still have a social divide where some children were born into families that have an income disadvantage are finding it harder to keep up with their better off peers. So I think the most important issue in Bristol is that divide, and it is more stark in this city than it is in many others, and it still is. If I was in opposition, and let's just say in this election, probably unlike any other, I don't think we need to play the game that the next Labour government, the Green government or the Democrat government will, because you all know that's not the situation we're going to be in. There is going to be a Conservative government, Theresa May is going to be the Prime Minister, and you know, this is like 1997 or 1983 in that context. We're all going to be in opposition. The Tory policy that I think is the most divisive and will make Bristol even more divisive if it happens is about schools, and I wouldn't fight that all the way. I went to a comprehensive school myself, one of the largest comprehensive schools in South Wales, Mountain Ash Comprehensive School, and I was on free school here. So that informs my political values, and I think about schools might help a tiny number of people from rural backgrounds, but basically they'll make sure a lot of people get left behind even further now.
Thank you. Thank you for setting an excellent example of being within time. Wonderful. Thank you for your good asking.
So the most important policy in the Labour manifesto, the one I'm most excited about the entire manifesto, is something called the National Education Service. And the idea behind this is it should be something that mirrors the National Health Service with the principle of education from cradle to grave. And that should be high quality, it should be free at the point of access, and that there should be a way of people being able to fulfil their potential that you can get into at various points in your life. So it would include, for instance, reinstating full funding for the Sure Start programme that the Labour government set up in 1997-8, about then, when we first got into government at that time. I think that was a wonderful thing that we did there, which was trying to close the attainment gap between those at the poorest backgrounds and the hardest off backgrounds and those with the richest backgrounds. We still have a huge attainment gap in this city. In Lawrence Hill Ward, which is one of the poorest wards in the country, the poorest ward in Bristol West, less than 20% of young people will ever go to higher education. In Clifton, if you were born and brought up in Clifton, 83% of you will go to higher education. That's an attainment gap that I don't think is okay. Particularly given that it's a train between one and the other. That only takes a few minutes. So an education service that will be for everyone throughout all of their lives, how would that affect Bristol? Well, I've already mentioned the attainment gap. I think reinstating the Sure Start programme and the education maintenance allowance, which, for those who don't remember, was something which we introduced. It was a cash allowance paid directly to pupils aged 16, 17 and 18 who stayed on at school after 16, and that was to help them with books and travel and to help their families. And those two things really helped close and start to close the pay gap. Unfortunately, both of them were cut, not completely closed, but cut by the coalition government, and subsequently much, much more so by the Tory government that's come in the last 2 years. What would I oppose? I would absolutely resolutely oppose the current government's plan for grant source. I think they're divisive, there is no good evidence base that they're going to help improve pupil outcomes, and I think that wasting money on vanity projects like that is taking us away from giving all schools, all state-maintained schools, the money they need to do the job, so that, because every teacher wants to do their job well. No teacher goes into the job thinking, I want to be a bad teacher. They want to do the job well, but they need resources in order to do that properly. At the moment, teachers are struggling, they tell me, from tight constraints and really reduced resources. So I would oppose grammar schools because they're not helping the key problem that there is in school education. Oh, this is good, well done.
Thank you very much. Molly, fine.
So, the Greens really have a quite different view of what education is for and what's best for our children when they go to school. And I think the most important thing that we would change is the constant pressure for measurement and testing, measurement of schools and measurement of children. We would abolish SAT and we would abolish Ofsted, and we would allow teachers to make judgments about whether children in school are doing well. I think this would make a huge difference to children's lives across the country and obviously in Bristol as well. What I notice, I mean, I've got nieces who also go through the school system at the moment, and the comparison between what they went through and what my own children went through is that there's just a tremendous pressure to reach some kind of standard. And since nobody's really quite clear what that standard is, children are left feeling inadequate and stressed. And I really believe this is feeding into the mental health crisis we see amongst young people. And I just, who is it benefiting, this number that children come out with? You know, it's creating competition between schools, it's creating competition between children. I just think it's a mistake. I think school is about allowing children to flourish and be the best possible people they can be. And I think that the relentless testing is just, I don't think it's helping anybody. So that's what the Green Party would do. I think that would also incidentally take a lot of pressure off teachers and allow teachers to be more creative in what they're doing, instead of having to teach to the test and instead of having to worry about whether their schools are meeting the standard competing with other schools. To me, this is just training for a particularly sort of competitive type of economy that I don't think works very well either. And I think education should be about improving the person, creativity, and letting you be the best you can be. So that's where the Green Party's at with that. The most important thing to oppose at the moment, in my view, is the so-called new funding formula, which I think is just a cover for cuts to education funding. In Bristol, those cuts will mean £33 million less spent in our schools, which will mean a loss of 1,000 teachers. I mean, that's obviously going to impact on the quality of education. The Green Party is committed to funding schools properly, and we're committed to raising the higher rate of tax to 60% to pay for that. I think being a civilised society means funding your public services properly, and we're prepared to say people should pay higher taxes.
Great, well that's got us started. Excellent. So I have a number of pre-prepared questions, but I'm not going to go for those because I've got a feeling that people might have questions themselves. So I'm just going to stand here a moment and look and wait for some people to raise their hands. Lady Dare, thank you very much.
Do you think our education system, and I'm talking about the entire kind of gamut at the moment, is fit for the needs of the 21st century? Do you think that our education system, and I'm talking about the entire run of it at the moment, is fit for the needs of the 21st century economy?
Okay, could I encourage you to think not just about schools when you answer, if that's okay? Right, so I'm going to go random selection. Who's looking?
Hang. No, not at the moment. No, I don't. And I've already mentioned some of the things that we do differently. I think investing heavily in the early years is critical for developing skills that we need, but also the people that we need and the people to fulfil their potential. If children start school with already not just an attainment gap, a skills gap and a knowledge gap, but also a confidence gap about the ability to learn and the love of learning, that's not going to help them. And I think we have a system that needs reform both in early years, but also throughout the school and throughout lifetime. I've mentioned adult education earlier on, and I think adult education over the last 20, 30 years has gone in various waves of good funding and not so good funding. And certainly in the last few years, my mother, who's in her 70s, has been very sad to discover most of the classes that she wants to do keep being cut, unless there's a qualification at the end of it. There have been cuts to adult education. Now I think every one of us should have access to courses, to skills, to new things to learn throughout our lives, not just because they're good for the economy, but also because they're good for us. So those two things I would highlight in particular, partly because I've already talked about schools.
Thank you very much.
I think if you go to some schools in Bristol, just to pluck obvious examples, such as Redland Green School or St Mary Radcliffe School, the system serves you particularly well. And if you don't go to those sort of schools, then probably it doesn't, because the whole system is predicated on an exam factory ending at 16 and 18, where you're measured on whether you get 5 good GCSEs, including maths and English. And if you get 5 good GCSEs in maths and English, the assumption then is that you go on to university. And the vast majority of people who get that benchmark do. But what consistently fails people is the lack of attention that it's given to people who don't meet that benchmark, or indeed probably never were going to meet that benchmark, didn't want to meet that benchmark, but had other skills that the system wasn't enabling them to develop and wasn't enabling them to flourish. I spent my first 2.5 years as an MP from 2005 to the end of 2007 as a member of the Education Select Committee in the House of Commons. Remember, we had a report from someone called Andrew Foster, which some of you have probably studied, or you may have known Andrew Foster. And he referred to further education and adult education as the unloved child, unloved middle child of the English education system. And so much of the political attention and media attention is on schools, traditional schools and GCSEs and A-levels. Most of the rest of political attention media attention is on universities, and it will tend to be on the top universities, on the Bristol group universities, rather than the others. But hardly any political attention, civil service attention, or media attention is given to further education, apprenticeships, or the 60 plus universities that aren't considered to be the top universities, as the press would call them. And that's where we all fail collectively. We don't have an education system that serves everyone. It serves the elite very well, it serves the middle adequately, but it serves quite a lot of people in society quite badly.
Thank you,
Stuart.
You've disappointed me now, because you set me my homework, and I've done my homework. It's totally off the piece, but anyway, never mind, I'll go for it.
We are not ignoring
things. Okay, fine. I won't feel disappointed then. So I think it's a very important question you're asking, because obviously the economy is changing rapidly at the moment, and I think a lot of those changes are to do with things we need to do to respond to climate change, and, you know, I see them as very positive. We're moving beyond the era of fossil fuels, we're moving through a new industrial revolution, we're moving towards the green economy, and we do need young people who are skilled and excited about the opportunities that offers. Now, I spend a lot of time as an MEP going to schools, to visit schools, and before I was elected I worked in university, and it was slightly disturbing that the young people I was meeting and talking to really didn't have any interest in these kind of practical jobs. They were mostly focused on wanting to be a games designer or musician, or, you know, all very fine aspirations. But when I sort of tried to get them interested in the idea of installing solar panels or even setting up a company that makes solar panels, there's kind of no interest at all. And I'm not quite sure what we should do about that, but I do feel it brings us to your point that we're not really preparing people for the world we're moving into, the world of work we're moving into. One of the things that the Green Party is proposing in our manifesto for women is that as part of the whole STEM discussion and curriculum, we ensure that as we move towards the green economy, we put particular attention on women and make sure that in the new engineering skills that we'll need, women have a fair shout alongside men. But I think we also need to consider the fact that one of the changes that's happening in the labour market is that we will actually be doing a lot less manual work. You know, there's a centre in your own university for robotisation, and, you know, the decline in the amount of physical labour that's going to be required from us has to be responded to in terms of how we think about what we prepare young people for. So if we have a proposal for a basic income scheme to support people's livelihoods if full-time work is not available, but also I think they need to be supported in using their leisure time skillfully, building community. I mean, this could be a wonderful future, but not if you go through school expecting to have a certain kind of job, which then isn't there. So I would say that the education system is not responding to the rapid economic change that's going on, and I think that's really a priority for government. I think other countries are responding better, and here we're still sort of focused on maybe the jobs of the past instead of the jobs of the future. And I would say that the world is in rapid change because of globalisation and response to climate change, and the greatest skill you can have is the skill of confidence, so that you can be resilient when those changes come. And that rather takes me back to my previous point, because if what you're trying to do is get a certain number in a certain test, that's kind of the opposite of feeling fully rounded and as confident as a human being.
Oh, this is interesting stuff. This huge question. I mean, you know, this question, we're getting into education philosophy here, we're getting into what the purpose of education is. And what's so interesting is so much education policy doesn't really address that. It's tinkering, it's working on the immediate issue. So I want to give you a chance to talk to each other in a minute, just to see where the points of difference are, because I think we can all agree that the curriculum doesn't reflect the range of skills and attributes that you might want to develop. we're increasingly all agreeing that there are huge problems around mental health and skills and stats and so forth. So I think one of the things we want to do is just really tease out key areas of difference. But for now, Leon and then Lisa and then, sorry, I don't know your name. Hilary! Thank you very much.
Thanks, Keri. So the question follows on really from the previous comments, and it's what do the panel think are the impact of high stakes assessments and changes to GCSEs and SATs on creativity in the curriculum and the role of creativity, and what should be done about it?
So if you think we've hit the point, we've just had these massive swinging changes that have gone against all the policy that was there before promoting creativity. Now we've got EBAC, we've got a commitment to sort of traditional forms of knowledge. What's been the impact of that? And actually, what will you do about it? Are you going to interfere again? Are you going to support something? What's going to happen? So let's go Molly first, and we'll go back the opposite way.
Well, although I come from a long line of teachers, and many people in my family are teachers, and I was a teacher at university myself, I by no means consider myself an educational expert. So one of the things I would be doing is asking your advice about all these detailed issues. And I must say that as somebody who's pretty well educated myself, just thinking about, because this was one of my homework questions, and just thinking about it, I mean, I was completely sort of befuddled by the amount of information out there and by the changes going on, by the seemingly kind of inconsistent political demands that were being put on teachers and schools. I've already said that I'm not a big fan of rigorous testing, so the idea of more rigorous SATs, which I saw was a change coming along, didn't really thrill me, I've got to say. And changes to GCE, so they're now measured in terms of numbers rather than letters. Well, again, I mean, why are you getting GCSEs? I mean, I'm now somebody who employs people. When I get their CV, I need to understand what's on that. If you just change the way, you know, because I mean, I'm not saying no exams, but when young people take exams, you know, I need to be able to know what the exam scores mean. If they're constantly changing them as an employer, I don't understand what they mean. So it seems to me that the first impact is likely to be a great deal of confusion to young people, teachers and employers as well. And then also, if you're constantly assessing people in terms of these exams, you have much less emphasis in the school curriculum on practical skills, on social skills, on community education, on all those things that help prepare young people for life after they leave school. Is that right? Yeah.
Just like Molly, I'm not necessarily absolutely up-to-date and expert on the changes you mentioned, but I guess it's a continuation of what Cove started, under the coalition, with a more of an emphasis on structure and absolute facts that children have to learn. I've got some sympathy with that, because I think employers, to come back to your question about preparing young people for the world, for the new economy and the world of work, do have certain expectations of what they want from the education system. But they're not all about maths, reading and expression. They're also about work skills like timeliness, teamwork, and whether you call that creativity or whether you call it team playing or soft skills, which is a phrase I've always hated but never really thought of a better way of describing. I think employers, whether they're politicians or whether they're business people, do look for a sort of well-rounded person emerging either straight from school or from further education beyond that. The last Education Select Committee report investigation I do remember, ironically, was about creativity. So even then, back at the end of 2007, I can't remember which Labour Education Secretary it was, because we've got through so many, I think, under their rank. But whoever it was basically a precursor to Michael Gove, squeezing all scope for creativity out of the curriculum. There was a lot of cross-party concern about that at that time. So I don't think this is anything new. There was always a temptation for politicians of whatever government in the past to narrowly prescribe what should happen in schools and measure it. And I remember Tony Blair justifying that approach, that if you're going to put in huge amounts of public money into a system, then one, you expect reform, and two, you expect to measure the outcome. So all political parties are probably guilty of that to some respect. But sometimes I think we have to restrain ourselves and say we must allow for professional development of a young person, and if you're going to regard teachers as professionals, you must leave quite a lot of discretion to them to understand how to bring the best out of an individual, and all the individuals in the classroom are different, and creativity is important to the economy. If you're going to be a gamer, if an example of what Molly mentioned earlier, yes, you've got to be good at maths, you've got to be pretty creative as well.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So I was very fortunate that I had an outstanding arts education, and although I no longer make any of my living from the arts, the fact that I had that as an integral part of my upbringing and my education, I think has stood me in great stead. It's given me great joy. And I want every child to have access, to have the opportunity to have that joy and that part of their life. But also, it is good for the economy if we keep the arts in the curriculum, if we make them central, and if we turn STEM to STEAM. Because the STEM subjects all benefit from having the A put in there. But I want to talk a minute about teachers. So my experience of teachers is they will always pull out all the stops to make a success of any regime change. They may grumble, they may heckle the Secretary of State for Education at the MUT conference each year, and I'm pretty sure they do that across party. But my experience of teachers, they will try and make things work. But in the noughties, I heard teachers say regularly, they might grumble about this or that change, but they regularly said, I love my job. They have the facilities that they needed, they had the opportunity to pursue different subjects, and they said to me, to people, I love my job. I used to hear that, I don't hear that anymore. The last 2 years as a Member of Parliament, I've met a lot of teachers, I've been to visit a lot of schools, and I haven't heard teachers say, I love the job at the moment. I've heard teachers say, I'm really struggling. And I think taking the arts out of the curriculum, virtually from the EBAC, was criminal, frankly. But also just the impact of constant changes to the SATs methods, the assessment methods, the GCSE syllabuses, the SATs syllabuses, crushing everything into exams and removing continuous assessment from so many subjects, just grinds teachers down. And that's not a good way to do education. So I'm really unhappy about the long-term impact. What will I do about it? That partly comes into what will I do about teaching generally, what will I do about education. I mentioned the National Education Service. The fundamental plank of the National Education Service is educators. You have to treat teachers properly. You have to give them decent pay conditions. There's been a public sector pay freeze for the last few years, which has added to the effect of grinding teachers down. So you have to pay teachers properly, but you also have to value them. Some of you may have seen that the Labour Party slogan at the moment is for the many, not the few, which I personally love. I think some of you may be old enough to remember that we had that slogan a while ago. 20 years ago, in fact, as I recall. But the other slogan we had was education, education, education. And I still believe in that. Because it made a huge difference. The difference between bringing children up, and I had nephews and nieces going through school in the education system in the 90s and in the noughties, the difference was immeasurable. The difference to school buildings, the difference to teacher morale, the difference to the inclusion of the arts. Oh, we're not bringing it to the board.
No, you're all right. I'm trying to keep it. Yeah, no, that's fine. Thank you very much.
Okay,
good answers. I think when we kind of move forward, I think keeping on to policies moving forward, and we can talk about track record for most of you, but I think if we can keep thinking around what's going to happen next. Lisa, I wonder if you could.
Okay, then, well, my question, which is a prepared one that I might add to the list, but so, Thangam, you already mentioned about the low participation, particularly in Lawrence Hill, I think you mentioned, in terms of participation of people into higher education from communities like that in East Bristol. So, my question, the prepared one, is what do you believe has been the implications for the most disadvantaged groups in society of changes to the way that higher education? Obviously, it might be interesting if we've got the time, although Keri's very strict, to reflect on the fact that obviously with the four countries of the UK, they have very different approaches. We've almost got a little bit of a kind of empirical project there in terms of looking at the implications from those varied perspectives. But then I suppose if you don't mind, I mean, I just would like to tease out, sorry, I'll take one.
You are, yes.
I should be a politician. Yeah.
Okay.
striking. There's 7 years between them, but the level of debt they're carrying out into the world is very different. And, you know, we weren't incredibly wealthy, but we were fairly comfortable. But I think that still really caused them to consider whether that was worth going to university. And I also think that debt has caused a great burden and a great stress. And I think the approach to debt can be different in different kinds of classes and different kinds of families as well. And I think this idea that somehow you're investing in your education, I think it's really unhelpful. I see education as a social good, a public good. I don't think you should be encouraged to say, well, it's like some kind of insurance policy. I'll pay money now and I'll get benefit later in some kind of selfish way. So, you know, our fees are the highest in the world. There was no preparation for that. And compared to the US, for example, a lot of children stay at home and go to a community college, so they don't have to pay as much. So there's a way into university for poorer children, which is often not available to young people in this country. And I also think it's desperately unfair that when students come to university, some of them who come from poor families will be working at the same time to pay their way through. Others will have the privilege of being given money by their parents. And yet when it comes to the exam, they're all compared equally. So, you know, I think we really ought to address that. I think we ought to address whether there is, in fact, a level playing field between different kinds of young people. I mean, our policy is to scrap tuition fees. I think it's essential. I think it's a necessary commitment to say we believe in education for everybody. And it's also to say that we need to repay the debts of young people who've already accumulated those debts, which is £76 billion. That's a lot of money. But I think, you know, as a civilised society, we should be doing that. I don't think you can leave some young people with that burden when others are not having that burden. And incidentally, tomorrow I'm launching a report about the crisis in student debt from a sort of more financial point of view. And what it actually shows is that the poorest people don't suffer the most because they actually, they never repay the loan, but as they go through their working life, they're paying a lot every month to a finance company, which is outrageous. The ones in the middle actually end up paying the most because they earn more and therefore they make a larger contribution to their life. And the wealthier students, even if they borrow money, if they go and become a barrister or something, they pay theirs off fairly quickly, so they accrue less interest. So depending on what you choose to do with your life, even though it looks like the debt was the same at the beginning, actually you're carrying very different amounts. And so that system is inherently unfair. It discourages children from poorer backgrounds to study, I believe. I know Stephen's going to say that's not true, but I think there are different decisions being made there. And it is creating a burden that I don't think young people should be carrying.
Well, you see, you said that who needs academics when you've got real life study between the home nations taking place at home? I don't know so much about Northern Ireland, but I do follow what's going on in Wales, Scotland, and England on this issue. And I'm sure you know that the biggest gap, the social gap, is actually in Scotland. It's not in England.
Yeah, well,
I'm not
with that argument, but we won't get
into it. Well, these are facts that are written by other academics that politicians read. And it is certainly is true that students from disadvantaged backgrounds in Scotland participate at a lower rate in higher education than students from a disadvantaged background in England. So on the face of it, you would say that completely free higher education, free in inverted commas, of course nothing is free, but free with no debt higher education in Scotland is not encouraging more students from poorer backgrounds to participate in higher education. And in England, where yes, there is that sector of how much debt you have to repay after you graduate is there and is talked about endlessly by lots of people, is not putting off the same proportion of students from disadvantaged backgrounds. In fact, since the change in 2011, the number of people overall applying to university has gone up. I think the number of people from disadvantaged backgrounds applying to university as a proportion has gone up as well. So sometimes the evidence is not what you expect it to be, and sometimes, frankly, it's politically inconvenient as well for people who've been against tuition fees in the past.
Come to this point, so the way forward.
Can I just come back to that point, because it really does bother me. You're right, but when we talk about facts, there's often much more nuanced arguments around that. And part of the difference in Scotland is that a lot of students go into further education, which kind of goes back to some of those earlier points, and they use that then as a route into higher education. But the actual data, which is often presented as fact, is more complex in terms of who is actually going on to higher education. The other thing is that the discrepancies aren't that large, and also in Scotland we started for whatever reasons in terms of the past history that are more base. So I just think, you know, you have to be really careful about necessarily taking on board at face value some of the evidence.
get frustrated with journalists in particular misusing data as well, so he was training in the use of data professionally. But it doesn't take away from what was my central point. You would expect, if you knew nothing else, that a system where it's free and a system where you're perceived as paying, although you don't pay, £9,000 a year, you'd expect there to be a yawning gap in terms of participation for poorer children in England as opposed to Scotland. And there is, so there doesn't seem to have been putting off that people predict. So the most important thing going forward, and when I was the Lib Dems higher education spokesman in 2010 and 2015, this is where I tried to shift the focus of my own party and failed to do so, which cost us dear, of course, is focusing on the living costs of students while they are students, rather than what they pay back when they're earning. Because that's where the real cost pressures are, that's where the real unfairnesses are, that students at Bristol University who come from a reasonably comfortable background get helped by the bank of mum and dad, and therefore can concentrate on their studies or enjoy their time at university. You come from a poorer background, you have to go and work in Sainsbury's or Wilkinson's or whatever, and that's the depth of your study. So actually going forward, it's looking at the maintenance costs of students, where I think you could make the most of the step change in encouraging people to think that university is affordable for them, as well as right for them.
Well, I looked at the Universities UK report from 2014 about the funding environment for university and trends in recruitment, and there were two key things that jumped out at me. One was that after the funding changes in 2011, applications to part-time courses, where an awful lot of lower-income families will go, or mature students, plummeted by 50% over 3 years. And I think that gets missed out of this debate, is that for a lot of people, their route into higher education was to go for a part-time course. And once the funding changes were introduced, that dropped off really, really sharply. The second thing that they picked up that really, really struck me was something I mentioned earlier, about the crucial factor influencing participation in higher education is prior attainment, which I know sounds tautologous, but what it's doing is it's reinforcing for me that you start here at early years. And by the time you get even to primary school, let alone secondary school, the gaps are getting bigger, unless you invest heavily in the early years. Now, I know Keri said don't go on about your record, so I'm not going to mention too much that Sure Start was an experiment that we started in the Labour government, which we would be seeing the fruits of now if it hadn't been cut back so much in 2011. The very first Sure Starters are applying for university or not at the moment. So where we are at the moment is, as a Labour Party, a Labour government, we try and redress the balance of the cuts that they've been to over the years. Because for me, that is the biggest way that we redress the gap between applications to higher education and both part-time and full-time, as well as funding changes. I actually think we do need maintenance grants properly restored. I know from my own family, my nephews and nieces, the ones who had a better funding regime to go to university on, it was a lot easier to make that decision. My niece last year said she really had to do a cost-benefit analysis. And if she hadn't had an aunt and an uncle, myself and my husband, in her family who benefited from going to university, and more importantly, who could say to her, if you get into financial trouble, we'll bail you out, I think she would have gone. And it shouldn't depend on having all of those factors. But really, for me, the reason that niece, particular niece, is able to make the choice to go to university is what happened to her in the early years. She got good primary school education.
Okay, well, we could so unpick where you invested. Yes. It's a really tricky balance. I want to give you a chance to say something about, have you heard one of your colleagues, candidates, say something that you really want to challenge or something that you want to pick up on? Or, there have been various raised eyebrows and disagreements of various points. Did you say anything? So, is it my
call? I'm not one now, I was disagreeing with him.
You were?
The way everything's gone back to the Department for Education now, and I don't don't think the officer inspections are particularly useful way of assessing what happens in schools, and they're incredibly stressful for the schools. So it's part of my general scepticism around the benefit of intensive measurements in terms of improving education, and particularly centralised intensive measurement.
Now we've clarified what the Green Party decision to find out challenge it. Wouldn't you accept there's a danger there, that if there was a local authority inspecting what in many cases be their own school, or a vested interest involved, given that something we would both agree on, because of our ludicrous electoral system, we have a lot of one-party state areas of local government, because certain towns in the north of England, Rotherham, Doncaster, and so on, where one party has been in power for a long time because of an unfair electoral system. Do you think a local authority could really be trusted to challenge failure and underachievement by schools when probably the same people are involved in the political structure?
Well, I agree with you the political system isn't working well, but I'm still a believer in democratic systems and political oversight rather than bureaucratic oversight from central government.
Okay, interesting. Then, any comments on that one, or do you know
what to get wrong? I think we need to be really careful as there is a balance to be struck. I know a lot of teachers who talk to me about Ofsted being stressful, but I also know that a lot of those self-same teachers, when their school is assessed as good or outstanding, are really pleased to put the flag out outside the school, saying this is a good or outstanding school. And I celebrate that. Actually, I think that one of the problems with calling school league tables, is people have thought of them as the analogous to football leagues, and of course they're not. Because in football, there is a winner and a loser. Now, in schools, actually, it is technically possible, in theory, for all schools to be good or outstanding, if they're given the right support. I actually do think assessment's good when it's done well and by people whose teachers respect and trust, and if they are able to get good and useful feedback. And I think that where it's not done well, it demoralises people and puts them under pressure. However, I'm going to challenge, I think, both of you, in that I think, maybe just Molly, actually, my experience is that all teachers do assessments. There's this great myth out there, until the system was imposed, teachers never assessed. Of course they did. Good teachers always want to know, what is it that's working with this child and not working with that child? How do I get these children to concentrate more? That's done by assessment. In fact, assessment is part of education. And I think what matters is that you have an assessment system that teachers believe in and buy into and feel part of. I think that's when it works at its best. And I think respecting the fact that teachers actually do have quite a lot of knowledge about how to do assessment should be part of the assessment system. But I don't want to throw out any babies and bathwaters. I think it's actually helpful that we are finding ways, they may not be perfect, they need to be improved, but I think it's good if we're finding ways of supporting all schools to provide the best teaching and learning, and assessment's part of that.
So I should clarify that we absolutely believe in teacher assessment, and that's what we believe as a substitute for kind of bureaucratised assessment laid down by central government. I think we should trust teachers as professionals to assess what's happening with children and many people in their classrooms, and then we should have a small number of external exams. I think the constant assessment of teachers, of schools and of young people is just causing pressure and stress in the system. It's part of the reason teachers are leaving the profession, part of the reason young people have mental illness. But I don't think it's complete free-for-all. I'm not just talking about a big hippie future where nobody ever assesses anybody. But I trust teachers to be professionals and to do the assessment in the classroom.
Thank you. Well, I think that was a very useful set of clarifications. Okay, Hilary,
well, I think that ties in very nicely with what I was going to ask. Thank you for doing that. I'm a fairly newly retired senior leader in assembly school. And recall when Mike Gove became Secretary of State. And that's when the rock set in, I would say, because him and the Department of Education began to rubbish teachers. And, you know, that's where we stand still since then, because we've had various Secretaries of State for Education who have continued on the Gove line, basically. And part of, as a senior leader, I would mentor both student teachers and NQTs. And, you know, I would see many NQTs get to about year four when they're teaching and throwing the towel. I saw the same people as student teachers who were full of enthusiasm and being NQTs full of enthusiasm and then burn out and say they can't do it. And the thing about teaching is it's a really good profession. It still has a good pension, not as good as it used to be, but it does. It has great qualities. You work really hard and you're at the end by the time you get to a whole bit, but it's a really good profession. But what we're doing as a government at the moment
Secretary of State.
What
would you do to change that? Because I think it's a little bit more than just that. It needs radical change.
So what are you going to do about teacher recruitment, retention, how to make the profession work? Well, what's like actual policies, please, not just like nice, we should respect teachers. I'm going to go to Stephen,
well, I was the prep school spokesperson briefly in the 2005 department, and I've spoken at numerous NUT and ASUT and other organisation events in Parliament and at party conferences over the years, and I've always made a point of saying I owe everything in my life to the fact that I had people who believed in me, who encouraged me, who praised me, who worked in their lunch times to help me do the extra O-levels that I did in school, that helped me get through both my O-levels and my A-levels, and encouraged me to go to university, because there was no expectation in my family that would be the case, and there was frankly not much of an expectation in the school or community that that would be the case as well. I had 300 people in my year group. I was the only person in 1985
who left.
Part of it was about the language.
Yeah.
Why is the teaching profession run down? And I agree with you. That's because our political class is narrowly drawn from people who went to a certain sort of school, i.e. a private school, or went to a certain sort of university, usually Oxbridge. And Thangam, I'm sure, will recognise this as well. Parliament and the civil service is absolutely stuffed full with those people, and doesn't have many people at all who actually had an ordinary upbringing. So when you've got an ordinary upbringing, you can say quite clearly, I was helped by people like you, and actually one of the best things anyone can do in society is to become a teacher. I've always said that as a politician, so you certainly don't get the denigration of teachers from me, I hope not many of my colleagues either. Really, what we need to get to is where teaching is seen as a desirable profession on a par with going to work for PwC or doing the fast stream exam for the civil service. That's what we've got to get the step shifted in terms of people's perception. Well, part of it is the language, by having that parity of esteem with other professions. But this is to be blunt, and let's take a risk. Well, I think most of you aren't, you're retired classroom teachers from what you were saying. Teachers themselves sometimes don't help themselves either. The annual spectacle of those Easter conferences, where yes, there's the ritual booing of whoever the Secretary of State is from any party, or the perceived militancy, doesn't really help give the impression that it is a profession that some people from universities might want to join. So I think there needs to be internal rethinking as well, that if you want to be treated as on par with accountants, lawyers, architects, civil servants, then the teaching profession is, I suppose to be blunt, needs to have a think about how it's perceived itself. It's not just about other people talking about it, it's the impression it gives itself.
All right, that's an interesting point, I'm sure that will fire you. Molly, and then
so,
what are we going to do, please?
Yeah, well, I mean, my view is that Michael Gove attacked the teachers because it's a clever profession and he sees there's political opposition there. And I think that's one of the Tory strategies generally. They go for people who they think are political opposition to them, and I think they've identified the teachers as being a feisty opposition, so I congratulate them for that. But, you know, I regret the Labour decision to try to measure things, as I previously said, and I think Tony Blair said something like, you know, if you can't measure it, you can't change it, or something like that. I think that's a real mistake. I think professional standards are very important. I don't think you can measure judgment. I think you train as a profession, you have respect and pride in your profession, and then that is something valuable that has nothing to do with monitoring or testing. And I say that as somebody who was a university academic, and I think it applies right across the education profession. You know, my daughter-in-law is working as a teacher now, and I don't know how long she's going to be able to carry on because she just works such extraordinarily long hours. I think 19 hours beyond what they're paid for, what the Department for Education funds most teachers do. Why would you carry on doing that? You know, you're not doing the wages, you're not being respected. So what would we do? We would end the public pay freeze so that teachers are paid properly. We would invest $7 billion in schools, making sure the schools are funded properly so teachers weren't under so much pressure because school staff weren't being lost. And we would trust teachers to be teachers and take a load of testing and monitoring off them.
Thank you. all, first of all, thank you for your service to our children. I'm really grateful that so many people are willing to go the distance and stick in the teaching profession, because I too think it's one of the best and most important professions there is. My mum's a teacher, my sister is a teacher, and I know how hard they work. My niece is a teacher, she's a newly qualified teacher, she's actually 2 years on from NQ2 status. So she tells me a lot about what life's like teaching in a city, London, in a London school, and it's tough out there. We would, a Labour government would pay teachers better by removing the public sector pay freeze. It's in the Labour Party manifesto. We would give teachers more say in the curriculum. I mean, I think teacher involvement in curriculum is really important because you're the experts, not politicians. We would treat teachers with the respect that they deserve. We would want you to have a structure that you want to work within and the one that you believe in, but the funding to do the job. What I see at the moment is teachers telling me that they've got constraints that they don't buy into and no money to fulfil them either. So they've got the worst of all worlds. I think we need something where there's a balance between having a structure of expectations, but that has to be with teachers' views built into it. That has to come from teachers, to be part of the language of how we do that. We oppose grammar schools, the new grammar school plans. We would scrap the free schools programme, and we would invest heavily in continuing the rebuilding for schools programme that we had when we were in government, which was sadly slowly ground down over the last 7 years, and make sure that every school had the facilities it needs. Some schools in Bristol West are amazing. They had massive investments between 97 and 10, and some missed out just by virtue of being too late on the list to get their refurb. So Cabot School, for instance, in St Paul's, badly needs some investment, whereas Cotton School, Red and Green have all had significant investment in that time. And you can really see the difference. It makes a difference to valuing teachers. I think they know that they are valued more if they have not just good pay, but also good facilities to work.
Thank you. Okay, well, there are now a lot of questions, and we are moving rapidly towards running out of time to complete pay. So I'm going to take a couple of questions that, if you can answer really, really quickly, and we're going to come back to a couple more questions. So this becomes a quick fire round, okay? So one here, the lady there, and the gentleman back there. No, not you, but there, behind you. Thank you. Okay, so quick questions, not statements.
You made it quite clear you're against selection by perceived academic ability. What about selection by parents' religion? And given that we are where we are in the system we've got, what would you want to do and what your parties planning to do about the situation we have?
Thank you. Very interesting question.
Education is not only important here, but also worldwide. What could and should be done to foreign policy to make education more inclusive and more better quality worldwide? And may I speak very quickly and ask the same question?
No. I'm sorry. These are two massive and enormous and different questions. You don't get to ask two. All right, so selection by religion, and what do we do to improve the quality of education worldwide and diversity and inclusion? Okay, you get a minute each.
Selection by religion. I think we should reform the entire admissions system. It's not working for an awful lot of children. The last 2 years, a lot of my casework as an MP has been helping parents and children who've been cut out of their local school by really unfair admissions processes. So Labour government would reform the entire admissions procedure, and that would include selection by religion. What should be done to foreign policy to help education worldwide? There's so much. We could write an entire essay on this, so I'm just going to say one thing, which is that children in refugee camps are missing out on years of education. I would make them my first priority. And over the last 2 years, I spent a lot of time working on refugee issues as chair of the All Party Parliamentary Group for Refugees. That would be my number one foreign policy and education priority.
Thank you very much. I'd like to consider.
I'm quite worried about the way religious schools work, because I think that there's some very good religious schools out there and they provide very good education, but my worry is they start to divide us into different communities within the overall community, and so I would like to see them phased out. I don't think you should be able to select on the basis of religion. I think it's causing divisions in our society and is unhelpful. I also agree with Thangam that the admissions policy generally is not working well, and I think we're seeing more inequality and less social mobility as a result of that. My answer to your question is that we've got a policy to increase the foreign aid budget from 0.7% of GDP to 1%, and I think a lot of that could be invested in education to one of the most useful things you can do to help poorer countries of the world advance.
Thank you.
On religious schools, if faith-based schools. The Liberal Democrat Manifesto doesn't say that they would be phased out, but personally, I would like to see us get to that position that you shouldn't have state funding of education based on faith. If people want to pay for that to go to an independent school that is faith-based, whatever the faith is, that's fine. But I don't think taxpayer money should over-reward one particular denomination against another, which is what we have at the moment, that Church of England schools obviously have a huge financial staking system, but there's very little funding for newly arrived faiths. And that does cause a lot of resentment by some people being my constituents and constituents. But I don't think you can abolish them, because we are where we are. It would be very difficult to untangle it. On what you can do around the world, I'm proud of the fact that the coalition government did get us finally to, despite all the other difficulties we're facing, got us to 0.7% of the economy spend on overseas aid, I think it was in 2013. And then we legislated to make sure that proportion was kept going forward, so it binds at the moment future governments. My family have taken an interest in refugees. I've actually been to an under-run school in Gaza and seen where education makes a huge difference for helping children who have very traumatised backgrounds. But I think investment in the education of girls is probably where you can make a huge difference around the world, to raise the esteem of women in certain communities where you can make massive differences in healthcare, child expectancy and so on.
Thank you. Okay, two last questions. So the gentleman
there in the glasses
and
the
other bit.
Children with special education needs continue to be some of the biggest losers of our education system. Children with special education needs continue to be some of the biggest losers of our education system. Exclusions for primary age children, 4-year-olds, are on the increase. This morning alone, I was with a teacher who was in tears because she was having to choose between the constraints placed on her and what she knows as a professional human that a child needs. So my question is, what do you think should be done with the education system so that it better meets the needs of children with special educational needs and disabilities?
Thank you.
Excellent.
Okay, I think Molly laid out sort of an alternative view, also an alternative for it, but I'm just wondering what Stephen and Diamond think, how they think Ofsted should be reformed, if it should be.
Okay, so we've got a question on special education needs, so we can address those, and what should we do with Ofsted? Well, Molly, you can go first, because you've already said what we do with Ofsted, so you can go.
It's clearly the case that we are failing children with special education needs, and it's part of the way in which the coalition government and now the Conservative government have actually targeted the cuts that they've made on some of the most vulnerable people in our society, in this case children with special education needs. So we're committing to ensure that every child with special education needs or a disability has access to the mainstream education, which is required under the UN Convention for Persons with Disabilities. And this includes making sure mainstream schools are properly supporting disabled children, and we're prepared to put in the money to do that. I think it's a basis of
closing special schools.
Sorry?
Closing special schools.
Well, I think it is better to include them in mainstream education, but with the support that they need, yeah.
Well, I think you're that. I think you have to assess what is appropriate to bring out best for the child, and in many cases a special school is where you'll get that therapeutic learning environment that is essential for stimulation of children. There are some special schools in Bristol. They may be co-located, so for instance Claremont School is co-located with Red and Green. I quite like the idea of having a sort of co-located campus of
children.
Well, they are actually next door to each other. How much crossover there is between children and teachers, between the two, I genuinely don't know. But I think that is possibly a compromise between having no special schools at all, which I think a lot of parents would certainly oppose. I said a lot of parents used to come and see me when I was an MP, wanted more special provision for their child, particularly if they had autism, for instance. And there were a lot of conditions that aren't diagnosed or detected early enough amongst children that can cause them problems later on, whether it's autism or dyslexia. So I think there does need to be more investment in finding out what is causing a child a problem while they're young, in order to make sure the right educational intervention is made later on.
And
Ofsted. Ofsted, we wouldn't abolish, in fact we would extend the remit of Ofsted so they can inspect the providers of education, not just the educational setting. So in many cases that will also be the local authority, maybe for primary education these days, but they'd also be able to inspect academic chains, which is a big sort of missing link in the system, I think.
Thank you. I'm going to say the second one first, an alternative view of Ofsted. Labour and I, we believe that there should be local oversight, there should be much greater local oversight, and it should be of all state-funded schools. So the ones that currently get to sort of opt out of oversight, we really want them all in the oversight. But to come back to children with special education needs, autism, for instance, is a spectrum, as I'm sure you know, and there are children on that spectrum who definitely benefit from being in mainstream school and thrive, given the right support. And I know many children and adults who are in that situation. There's autism in my family, and my husband works with children on the autistic spectrum. And some of the children he works in a special school. So for some of the children, the anticipated outcome, the goal they're working towards, is getting that child to the point where they can move on to a mainstream school. And that happens for a lot of them, but some of them are non-verbal, they are doubly incontinent, they are unable to walk properly, they have multiple other disabilities that are associated with autism, some of them, and some of them not. Some of them will never thrive in a mainstream school. And I think there has to be provision for children who are going to be better able to fulfil their potential in a setting which has really intensive one-to-one support and care and educational facilities. For some of the time, some of those children will always need to be cared for their whole lives. And I think we need to get much, much better at understanding how we can expand that potential, for sure. I absolutely do. And I believe in special education because I think I've seen it in my own family, as I said, but also when I visited schools. But I think teachers tell me in mainstream schools that they desperately want to have more time to train to have better skills themselves. Because I know in for instance, Glenfroom, which is a local school where I was a governor for a few years until quite recently, that very often children would have done a lot better had the school been able to budget for the additional support that it needed. And the teachers really wanted that to work, the parents wanted it to work, the children wanted it to work. And it could have worked even better if we just had enough funding to do it.
Thank you. I want to ask one, take chair's privilege, and ask one last question, which is, how are you going to work together over the course of the next government to ensure that at a time we have Brexit, we have a huge amount else going on, that education stays higher up on the agenda? So we have seen it drop off. We know that it is being neglected in a whole variety of different ways. How are you going to work together as parties to ensure that all of these issues that we've talked about today stay high on the political agenda? What are you actually going to do as individuals? If you're elected as MP, what would you do to make sure that education does not drop off when everything else comes? Right.
Well, I mean, first of all, I would like to work with Paul Goldman to stop there being a Tory government, because he never still deserves a candidate and he wanted to show up.
Yep.
So I think that's what he's telling you. We work very hard to try and organise a progressive alliance. It didn't happen, but you know, I think we could have stopped there being a Tory government. I think, as Stephen said, if we had a PR system, we wouldn't be ending up with a Tory government. You know, they will not get a majority of the votes. Anyway, the likelihood is that we will be ending up with a Tory government. And I think already the way MPs work genuinely is that they do cooperate. And I think that in the Parliament that's coming, there will be cooperation between the different political parties. But if you're looking for cooperation in politics, what you need to do first is change the electoral system. You need something more like a European system. To me, we're in a constitutional crisis. And
this is not a question about cooperation. This is a question about how you ensure, when you are elected in the government, how you ensure that education becomes a priority when there are so many other competing priorities. So what will you do to ensure that education is thought about, considered, and discussed at a time when we've got so much else going on?
Well, I will ask you what I need to do. I will work with you and you. I think that's the thing. You're the experts. I've come here not as an expert. You know a lot more about this than I do. And then on your behalf, I'm very happy to go and advocate and to be a strong critic of whichever Tory minister is doing the latest decimation of education. I'm particularly happy to do that in the case of grammar schools, which we fundamentally oppose.
Thank you. Stephen?
Well, MPs do work more collaboratively than they're often given credit for. I mentioned I was a member of the Education Select Committee for 2.5 years, and that was one of the best experiences I had when I was an MP, working with Labour MPs and Conservative MPs on a range of issues. And actually, when you sit people down together, when you're not in a confrontational atmosphere, you're sat in a horseshoe, when you're listening to expert witnesses coming in and asking them questions respectfully rather than confrontational way, you learn a lot. And I only wish, this is a prism of all governments, including the one I was in, that governments paid more attention to the well-thought-out reports that all select committees produce, rather than go with whatever their instinct was. And the example I used to give was over school lunches, where the education select committee that I was a member of recommended high nutritional standards in school lunches. The Labour government totally ignored it, and Jamie Oliver made his TV programme, and suddenly they're all over the issue. And that's a failure of politics. Well, on a cross-party basis, the committee got it right, but the single-party government didn't want to listen. So I will always work with people from other parties if we can find a way forward. And I think a lot more of that goes on in politics than certainly the media will ever show you.
There's one very clear way that as an MP I will continue to keep education and Bristol's residents' education high on the political agenda. Let's keep talking about it in Parliament. There are various tools you have as a Member of Parliament. So, for instance, on funding, I've put down several what are called written questions. They're publicly available. It means the Secretary of State is required to answer. Those answers are public. You can use them to scrutinise and lobby. I take the guidance for those questions very often from the suggestions that people make. I always make my own decision about which questions I put down. That's one of the ways you hold the government to account. Oral questions, people often know about Prime Minister's question time, but every single Secretary of State has to answer oral questions on a rolling basis every 2 or 3 weeks. And I would continue to make education questions a priority. So if you stand up in front of the Education Secretary of State and say publicly, on record, it's on TV, it's recorded in the hands of, what are you doing about the funding for schools in Bristol? But you also have to work with the schools locally, not just schools, but also the nurseries, also the universities. You have to meet with lecturers, with teachers, with head teachers, with nursery teachers. And I have done that throughout my short time as an MP. 2 years that I've been an MP, I've visited as many as I could possibly fit in, and I also survey teachers regularly, head teachers in particular, about funding at the moment in particular, and I talk to parents and I talk to children. And if you know, as I do, very deeply, that education is the fountain from which everything else comes, it is the most important thing we do as politicians, is to support the education system, and I do believe from cradle to grave is a good phrase there. It informs everything. It informs every single debate, every single question you put down. So you would see me on my record, you'd be able to look, you can look now at what my record is so far. You'd be able to see it, you'd be able to scrutinise it. If you didn't think about doing enough, you'd come and tell me. Because actually, the people of Bristol West always do. They do, it's the tourists. Bristol West, if you go to the writeyourmp.com website, you'll see that Bristol West regularly outstrips virtually every other constituency every single month. And I think that's a good thing, that people tell their MP, me when it was me, what I was doing wrong, what I need to do more of.
So I would like to thank the three of you. I'd like to thank you for taking the time and energy and effort that it takes to participate in the democratic process. I am sure you are exhausted. And it is hugely appreciated because this really matters. We appreciate you coming here. We appreciate you putting your views forward. We appreciate the care and the thought that you've put into preparing. And we appreciate the spirit within which you've engaged in this debate. So thank you very much for that. If you'd all join me in thanking them. Happy to try to work and to support whichever of you is elected in the future. So thanks again, everybody. Cheers.